Welcome back to the Et Cetera's podcast. As always, I'm your host, Eddie Gonzalez, and today I have a special guest host, the first person to come back, so you have that distinction, my guy Kyrie Irving. Yes, Kai, how you living, man?
I'm great, man. Great. Taking it one day at a time. Blessed.
So we come in, this is 2 days since the unceremonious into your season.
Yeah.
How soon are you back in the gym? Like, you was hooping this morning or?
Nah. I had to decompress, reflect, and it's only been 48 hours.
Right.
But so there's about so much you could do in that amount of time. But I've just been at home with my family, you know, really just dedicating time with them, being intentional with all that, and just catching up on things that I probably missed out on throughout the season.
So I heard, I just need you to confirm this rumor. I heard you play 1-on-3 as part of your training and just hoop, like, just get after it.
That is true.
Why, like, what?
I can confirm that.
What are you doing that for? Like,
just trying to work on so many different situations that can come across the game.
You know how mad I'd be if I was one of the three
and you scored? And I scored?
Yeah. I got your left hand, he got your right.
That's the point. That's the point, man. But honestly, it's just having a creative way to look at the game.
Yeah.
You know, just somebody's on my left, somebody's on my right. It's not always going to be like that. But, you know, when you have somebody contesting you and bumping you a little bit more, it helps. So just try to be creative in my workouts.
Like, decent bodies, too. This isn't like me and my two boys. These are like, you know, decent sized
folks. These are players.
Folks.
These are players, you know. They're not playing at the highest level that I'm at, but they definitely are part of my team when we go into the summertime or when I'm trying to get back in shape. They help me out.
Yeah, that tripped me out. I'm like, yo. But I bet you kill doing it either way, which is the worst part about this whole thing.
Yeah.
So this season has been a roller coaster. You've talked a ton about all of this. I feel like you've been wild open, you know, as far as these are controversial things, these things people are worried about. What I wonder as a fan, as somebody closely to the situation, was there ever a point in there where you're like, nah, I'm just going to just come back. I'm like wavered on what you wanted to do.
Yeah, I think, you know, I'm glad we have this space to talk about it because I felt like I've been as open as I could be as well, or as I can be. And, you know, it's hard to be transparent in this space where, you know, everybody's holding on to every single word that you're going to say. So I try to find a healthy balance with, you know, being authentically me, speaking honestly, but also just being conscientious of other people's feelings and the other people that represent family members of mine. You know, I've said it so many things in my life, you know, whether it be in public or in private conversations that could be controversial, right? Or they can, you know, make someone think a certain way about me. I really don't pay attention to that as much now. But I've just been able to learn and grow in this space to be able to learn, like, hey, I can articulate how I feel about certain issues, but some things I got to keep close to my chest because, you know, not everybody's going to understand, you know, not everybody understood my stance this year of being unvaccinated or remaining unvaccinated. You know, I was asked in all different types of ways about how I felt and whether or not I was going to waver. Did I feel like, you know, I was letting the world down or letting Nets fans down, or letting my teammates down. And yeah, part of that letdown feeling definitely seeped in because, you know, it completely caught me off guard. I didn't expect to come into the season with all of this being put on my plate. You know, it was like an ultimatum given to me. It's either you work and get vaccinated, just like, you know, this ultimatum was given to other people, or you sit at home and, you know, now we get to talk shit about your decision and you personally and, you know, make all these judgments and stuff like that. So I had to deal with both ends of the spectrum, right? So I sat right in the middle and I knew I was doing the right thing for me.
Yeah.
And I had to stay rooted in that decision. And I'm grateful that I had a great support system around me that helped me get through it because it wasn't easy, man.
So when the conversations do start about you coming back part-time, where does that come from? Like, did you approach it? Were you approached? How does that begin? And then it kind of goes from there.
Well, I was approaching the team, you know, almost every day or every week, like, hey, is there any progress, status? And, you know, trying to get in touch with the mayor's office, trying to get in touch with you know, our political figures, our political leaders to figure out, you know, how do we work around this? I talked to scientists. I talked to health professionals. Mm-hmm. I went down the checklist of, hey, is there any way that I can work around this? You yeah. know, and really what I ran into was, you know, it affected so many people, brother. Like, it affected so many people, not just in New York City, but across the whole entire world. So, you know, I was getting general answers back because they were not trying to make it, hey, we're just trying to get you to play and, and give you special, you know, treatment. So I had to respect that, and I had to honor that and go back and talk with, you know, my support system, figure out what was the best way to approach this. And you know, that's what we did.
Yeah, I think that's a great point because it kind of got spun into like, yo, this is only Kyrie, but literally like thousands of city municipal workers were fired and there was protests and it was affecting a lot more, obviously, than just you.
Yeah.
It is a little tricky that, you know, all of a sudden the Yankees and Mets can't play and then all of a sudden there's some progress, but that's another debate for another day.
I don't even want to debate it. I'm like, I'm just happy for those that can stand firm in what they believe in and still be able to make a living.
Yeah.
You know, when things come up in our society where they impact people's decisions based on real life circumstances, you know, like people have kids, people have families, and I just feel like it got confusing for a lot of us.
Yeah.
You know, it got spun, like you said, in so many different ways, but really what I was standing on was, hey, there's a whole community of us, right, that have been labeled as the unvaccinated, as the conspiracy theorists, whatever, you know, we've been labeled as whatever these names have been brought to our lives, right, and who we are as people. But I was just saying, I am human. Mm-hmm. You're human. You have the right to make your own decision. I respect that, and I pray that you respect me in the same way. But when you're playing in an entertainment game or you're playing in, you know, kind of a bigger game than yourself, it has rules. So
that's very particular set of circumstances for you. It was crazy. As we get to it, you then become the only player in the NBA that is dealing with this particular set of circumstances. You're not the only you're still not the only unvaccinated player. So even though it gets spun that way, you know, it was very tricky situation, obviously, for you. For sure. When you get back on the court, how long did it take for you to feel back, like acclimated, or you're just boom right at it?
You probably gonna be like, what? You serious? Like I never felt like I was.
I knew you were gonna say that.
I knew what I was gonna say.
I figured. Now you dropped 50 and 60 in the same week, and you still never felt back.
There was nothing to lose. You know, it was only, you know, like the journey to enjoy at that point, because I was sitting at home, and I don't even want to say sitting at home. I was wondering at home what my future was going to look like, you know, whether I was going to be traded, whether I was going to be released, whether I was going to get the opportunity to be on another team, how I was going to spend this for myself in a positive way, you know? So I kept affirming to myself, things are going to change. You know, I had people around me and I'm grateful for them affirming that things were going to change. But I never felt like myself throughout the season, because I'm usually sustaining a level of growth throughout the year instead of trying to catch up with everybody that's been playing for 4 or 5 months. You know, they've been at it every day since October or September. You know, I was at it maybe September, October. I was healing from my ankle injury. Yeah. I was still dealing with that. And when we got into training camp in San Diego, I was not expecting, you know, a mandate to be brought down in a way that it wasn't going to allow me to play at all. Like, you know, I had the opportunity to play away games still, but there was no plan in place. There was no vision of, like, how it's going to work for our team. And I think that really impacted not just me, but a lot of people. So, you know, just had to sit in that hot seat for a little bit and deal with it, man. Life of a martyr, bro.
I don't think you're getting out of the hot seat anytime soon. I think
I'm okay with that.
That's just your seat for now.
I'm okay
with that. The ankle injury, I'm happy you mentioned that. So, not to dwell on last year, but how close were you to playing at that point? Like, you're playing in the next round, you're missing that. I remember seeing you in the arena with the scooter, and I'm like, oh, he's not going to play no time soon.
Yeah.
How close, how far were you from that?
That was by far my most traumatic ankle injury.
It was a bad time.
Yeah, it was. And if you look at the video or the image, the still image of it, my ankle was 90 degrees on the floor.
You touched floor, yeah.
And what made it the worst one was the height I was coming down at, because I had just shot a floater. And, you know, bro's foot was right there, and I come down on it, and it didn't twist right away and come back. It was on the ground for a second, you know, and I felt it, and I felt like I broke my ankle. Yeah. So I was scared. I was nervous. And when injuries happen at the height of the, you know, playoffs or your season or your postseason, man, that's not something you want to deal with. So that aspect took into play, you know, had to be taken into play. And I didn't start walking normal probably until like mid-September, end of September. So training camp was like my first time going up and down and getting back my feel. So I knew it was going to be a process for me to play again, but it would have been accelerated being around the guys and playing game speed. You know what I mean? So now when the mandate was dropped, I'm at home with, you know, my healing ankle, but I'm not getting NBA basketball anymore, you know, or NBA run. So I had to be creative and just play the waiting game, bro, and wait until all of this stuff, you know, kind of calmed down and there was some light at the end of the tunnel.
You've dealt with injury at the, I mean, all injuries at the worst time, but you've been hurt in the finals, you know, your knee. That was another one. It was like, you were pretty banged up then. Did that inform, like, I can't rush back from this, even though it's the playoffs? Is obviously, it only ended up being another week, and there wasn't no decision to make after that. But was that part of the process at the time, too?
Two different situations, you know, just because I was dealing with a knee injury. You know, my ankle injury, it was a little bit more sensitive to me because I have to walk. You know, what I mean? My knee is like I could, you know, tie it together a little bit. You know, be creative with how I get my VMO, my quad firing and stuff like that. So I was able to get back into some type of form that I was at during those playoffs in 2015. But
gigantic brace on that leg at the time. Oh, I seen some footage recently and was like, yo, how do you for the way you play to play with that thing was nuts.
But that's the mental hurdle that a lot of athletes have to face in, you know, high pressure situations where your team is not necessarily relying on you, but they're depending on you to do everything you can to get back, which I did in those 2015 playoffs, but I just wasn't ready. You know, my knee was weak. It wasn't where I wanted it to be standard wise, but I gave it a chance, right? Yeah. And I ended up with a fractured kneecap and I was out for 7 months. And you look back on those decisions and you're like, hey, if I would have kept myself out, would that have been the right decision? Who knows, right? Yeah, no regrets in that. You know, I went after a championship and I live with the results. Got a scar that I look at every day that's a reminder. But my ankle injury was, it felt different because I honestly felt like my ankle was broken. Mm-hmm. You know, I couldn't do ankle moves as much as I wanted to, and I couldn't walk around the way I wanted to. So I was already under the impression this is going to take me more than just 2 weeks, 3 weeks.
Yeah.
It didn't hit me until we lost that, oh, this is going to take me
months.
3 months.
Yeah.
I'm going to have to get off my feet completely. And I'm a little bit of a wild card, you know, in terms of how I approach.
No way. Not you.
I'm a bit of a wild card, how I approach my body at times, you know, what I feel like I push myself through. And I kept trying to push myself through it. And even in the summertime to get ready for October, and that was – like it wasn't going, I wasn't progressing as I would have liked. So two different situations, but still mental and physical hurdles to get over that I look back on, and I wouldn't change anything except probably just being a lot more patient with myself.
So I want to stick with the Cavs run for a second. 2016, you feel like that's the highest level of play you've played?
Well, shout out to all my teammates on that.
I should have brought my hat. I had like the hat. I should have brought it and made you sign it.
Shout out to Cleveland, you know, on just the historical run. Our fan base was through the roof, you know, in terms of how we collectively galvanized each other and they gave us energy.
Yeah.
Were traveling on the road. I mean, it was called Quicken Loans at the time before it was Rocket Mortgage. The queue was jumping.
Yeah.
You know, Fred McLeod was doing the game still. Rest in peace to him. And we just had a good group. And that run was special because we had dealt with so much adversity in the regular season, mm-hmm. you know, internal stuff that we had to get right as teammates. Mm-hmm. And then going into the playoffs, we were like, man, we could deal with anything. You know, mm-hmm. we're going to sweep through a lot of these teams. But looking back on it, I think it just was more special because of the way we did it and the circumstances, situation that we were faced with. And I had to go deep within myself to bring out yeah. all of these tools that I had learned since, you know, I was learning fundamentals
yeah.
and just put them on display on the biggest stage. And I think that was one of the highest levels of play that I played, but it wasn't the highest for me that I look back on. Mm-hmm. Just because it was a short window. So it was like, just throw everything out there and hope something lands. So I was just throwing jabs and things were landing against the best. And when you start landing things against the best and you find that rhythm, that's what ended up happening. And also, by the way, I had a lot of help. Like, also confidence that was being given to me. Like, yo, Kai, just don't even worry about how many attempts that you're shooting. Don't worry about where you're shooting. Just be you, and we're going to do this as a collective group, but we just need you to be aggressive and not think about, like, oh, how do I be efficient in these spaces? So I had a lot of help. That's why I got to shout out the whole entire Cleveland area for that, man.
That game five is one of the most impressive performances as a duo, as individually, but to throw up 40s like you guys were and against that defense. The highlights from that series, your highlights, are, like, insane. The spinning jumper over Clay, the lefty lay and one on Dre, and you got poked in your eye. Like, these are, like, iconic plays in basketball, but, like, they made you work for them joints.
Absolutely.
And that's why I'm like, is that as tough as it's been? But you've played in a ton of tough series since then.
And that's why I say it was one of those like high level playing moments for me, because since then I've been challenged differently. Mm-hmm. You know, before it's easy to go in there. Me and Clay had a series against each other, but it was one game. You know, we didn't have a full seven games.
Yeah.
That was the first time me and him got to go against one another. Then we followed that up in 2017 going against them with Kev there. So that was history that was supposed to be made. You know, like, who would ever thought that the 7-3-9 Golden State Warriors be going against us again, and we would have a trilogy with that series, with me being there. And I had to really appreciate everybody that was on the floor at that time, because it's not ever going to be done like that again.
Yeah.
You know, all the ages, all of where I was 23, 24. Yeah. So there wasn't much that I was, like, envisioning that my future looked like at that time in terms of career achievements of winning a championship at that time. I was just like, man, if we make it there, I just got to ball out.
Yeah.
So now it's like I'm part of the ground building stage of, we put our team together, we put our organization together, we put our teammates in the right positions in terms of roles, and I'm now much more responsible for more. Mm-hmm. You know, I've taken on that responsibility of more. So yeah, the Cleveland days, man, they were really special as we reflect, but huge, huge learning experience, too, that I took from them.
That's what it seems like. I know you've talked about leadership and since that time and how that fed into that. Obviously, your years in Boston as well. Mm-hmm. So you're 30 now.
Yep.
Do you feel like you're in your prime? Like, do you view your career in that sense?
I'll say it again. I feel like I'm slowly crawling into it just as my talent becomes much more of a canvas for me to work with in the summertime and in the season. You know, finding motivation is playing different styles and figuring out what works for you. But I think at this point in my prime, as I crawl into it, it's consistently being at a level of enjoyable assassin's time. Right. Like, just being an assassin consistently for the next 4 years, 5 years. I won't even put a time, you know, expiration on it. It's just like being consistently great, where it's not so much about the numbers and the achievements and accolades. It's like, I'm on the best team and I'm one of the best players on the best team. And we've done it as a dynasty because we literally went through this over here in order to accomplish this. Mm-hmm. You know, I wouldn't be able to say I'm crawling into my prime without the experiences of Cleveland and then going to Boston and then signing up for Brooklyn and then now being in this situation now where we're 2 days out and we got swept.
Yeah.
And it's my first time in my career I've been swept.
Mm-hmm.
And now I have so much time on my hands to think about it and plan and envision. So, yeah, let's just say me turning 30 this year, it was like.
I can feel you, like, the energy of you just, like, I'm ready. Like, that video I talked about last time, you're just like, let's go.
Yeah.
So, what does Kyrie add to his game? I have my running joke is you've mastered the game. You have, there's no offensive tool you don't have.
Mm-hmm.
I told Kevin this. He kind of agreed. He's like, I got to see him hit a hook shot. I'm like, I bet he can hit a hook shot. Like, I bet he. But, like, our joke is, like, you can go right, you can go left. You can shoot with your left hand. You obviously incredible finishing. You can shoot from any range. We even see you dunking a little bit last year, not as much this year. Hey, you might
That's what I'm saying.
That.
I never
them
felt
calf
like,
raises, bro. Like,
I just never felt like I got back this year.
What
you
is
know?
There? But, what is there to add to that palette?
See, and that's probably why this year for me was the level of disappointment that I feel is not the level of disappointment I'm pretty sure that people had when they chose us to be contenders.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
know what I mean? It's just like I have a different level of expectation for myself. So when I'm working on my game and I'm being creative with how I'm approaching it, meaning, you know, what am I trying to accomplish today instead of just make a bunch of shots, you know, like – and even in the games, you know, what am I trying to accomplish today where it supersedes just going out there and get a bunch of points and assist and recreate moments for people at home? You know, like, let's be honest, you know, people really want those recreated moments. Like, no, be the same player that you were game five and be the same player you were, you know, when you had 14 straight games of 30 plus points or 25 plus points. And, you know, and I don't want to throw things that I haven't done, but
I think Kevin deals with this too.
Exactly. It's just after a while you – There's an easy expectation people throw on you to be at that level all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not part of my motivation. My motivation now is, hey, all right, yeah, it'd be great to add a hook shot, but, you know.
It's there. Like, yeah, don't lie. It's there.
It's there. But now I just want to put a complete game together, you know, or a complete strategy together and work on things situational-wise. So when we get into our postseason, which is the season that really matters, you know, once you're out of the carrot race, now you're into the physical and the dominant. I like to say, like, you go deep into your will when you're in the playoffs because now you're challenged beyond what any of the refs can control and any of what the other defensive coaches on the other team can control. You know what I mean? It's like you throw everything out of the window and it's just hoop and it's. Who can I dominate and how much will do I have in me to consistently do it to win four straight games?
Mm-hmm.
So adding to my game now is really adding to my own personal resume of being successfully dominant as a team and being one of the best players on that team. So if that means getting a few more assists, if that means taking a few less shots and being efficient with those shots, if it means taking more shots and being more efficient with that, if it means switching up my role, going from the one to the two or the two to the one or being flexible for my coach to throw me in there to guard bigs at times, you know, even though it's uncomfortable for me, I just really want to be complete.
Mm-hmm.
And that was one of the goals that me and my dad set out when I was a kid was just having a complete game. You know, I've been knocked for so many weaknesses that I have, but then, you know, somehow I end up in this category of being one of the most skilled of all time. And being one of the most skilled is a complete game that I want to be great at, you mm-hmm. know? So if I'm not consistently doing that, I love that criticism and I welcome that. But right now it's just focused on a personal resume of, I like to put together four straight years of just team dominance, winning 60 plus games, you know, going deep in the playoffs and having fun building relationships that don't just extend on the court. You know what I mean? It's a trust off the court that helps us win games and helps us win championships. Because I feel like I missed out on that, just consuming the game and trying to answer every question that everybody has for me of who can I be and what's the maximum potential that he can achieve. It's like, and I don't want to overspeak here, but last year when I started like dunking a little bit more, I had worked on my body to be able to do those things, and I saw results. Yeah. So when I had the type of season I had, I wasn't surprised. You know what I mean? Yeah. 50, 40, 90, and averaging 25 plus per game, I'm grateful for that. But I also am even more appreciative of the work that I put in before I got there.
Made it to that.
That's the threshold I'm talking about. It's like you put together a great summer, you put together a great, you know, first 3 months of the season, 4 months of the season, and then you're ready to accelerate and play off instincts even more, where who knows what can come out of the tool bag, you know, because I done worked on 1 foot jumpers, I done worked on hook shots, I done worked on dunking, I done worked on, you know, beating the other team up and down the floor with my conditioning. I done worked on all these things. So now I'm just playing off instincts and now I could just play the game. But comparative to like this year, I had to catch up, and playing catch up in a league that's only getting better, it's not the position that we like to be in. So
you've worked on the one, so you'll pull the one footer out the bag and it won't be just Kevin out there and Jokic doing that.
No.
Okay. No. I'm trying to make sure because Kevin, you know, his bag is deep as well. But we have a little debate about, you know, what about who's back. So this most skill combo, you wear that hat. You're good. I love that. Like people online are like, no. And then like Bron and D-Wade come out and go, yeah, those are those guys. They're really like that. Like, what are you talking about?
No, I'm grateful for our peer respect, but I'm trying to fall in a stratosphere that hasn't been done before, you know, and no label or title can ever justify that for me. Yeah. You know, I'm grateful for all the recognition and all the respect I've garnered. And part of me wants to live up to that. But then another part of me is like my own personal resume. What makes me happy is playing this way, being on great teams, being able to dominate our matchups individually, but doing it in a way where it doesn't just look easy, but it looks like, damn, you got to put in a whole lot of work in order to make it seem like do it like that.
Yeah.
That's where I feel like people kind of take advantage of what they see, you know, from greatness. And it's not just in basketball. It could be in different sects of the world, in different industries. But like when people make it look easy, it's like, I think somehow it doesn't register. Like it took a shit ton of time to be able to do it that way.
I think a lot of you guys suffered from that. I think Bron does. I think you do. I think Kobe did as well. Mm-hmm. I think Kevin does as well. Like it does look easy, but it took a lot of shit to make this shit look easy.